Hallelujah. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
It's good to be back together, isn't it? It says in the book of Acts, let's not forget that we are meant to gather together to bring our worship to the Lord. And what a wonderful thing that we're opening back up for public worship here at Fresh Wind Worship on Easter Sunday. So just a couple announcements before we begin. Thank you for walking in with your masks. We also will thank you as you walk out with your masks. As you're seated, you can take them off if you're around the people that you're normally with. But we'll ask you to keep them on while we're singing. And so since it's Easter, we're going to ask you to put them on. And if you are able, why don't we stand and sing our opening hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today. And we can celebrate that fact in our hearts and in our spirits.
Quite a year it's been. I was thinking last night how ever since Adam and Eve turned away from God, sin and sickness and disease and danger entered the world, and the world's been a risky place to live. It's just been risky since that time. And the element of fear has been a part of humanity since then. But when God's people gather together and they taste of his love, it says perfect love casts out fear. And I don't know about you, but it felt like we had a lot of fear come into our nation in the past year. And the church has always been a place where we work to encourage each other in a life of faith, in a life of hope, a life of joy, a life of peace, a life of really settled spirits in God. And I don't know if you've been reminded over this past year, but it's been a real reminder to me that there is no other true anchor for the soul than God Almighty. It's just not found anywhere else. There's no other anchor for the soul. There's no other place where you can find absolute life and power and truth. And we want to continue to be a place that encourages people. And we've tried over this past year I'll tell you what, it's just a lot more fun talking to people, isn't it? Walking up here than talking to an iPad camera. There's just energy when we gather together. And God has said, do not forsake the gathering together to encourage each other. Give courage to each other. And I'm so thankful we get to start doing this again. And yeah, it's limited, and yeah, we have rules. But let's keep praying that the Lord will open up our community, our nation, our world, to live in more and more freedom again, to encourage each other in the very purpose of life, walking faithfully with God. It's the whole duty of mankind, Ecclesiastes said. Fear God and keep his commandments. And we hope it's an encouragement to you, what we do here, and pray for us that we can continue to do this, we can continue to expand and open and share the love of Christ with people and let it touch their hearts. We're going to continue in song. We'll spend a little time in prayer in a little bit here, but we're going to continue worshiping the Lord together. And then I just look forward to bringing you a message in person this morning. Just excited about that opportunity. And we have a couple of special individuals that we're going to honor as well through this time. So we hope you enjoy this time together. Let's continue singing.
We have songs that declare what anchors our faith. And it's fact that Jesus went to the cross for your sin and for mine, but he didn't stay dead. Amen. The empty tomb is so important. But let's sing about these events that have changed all of humankind. One, two, three.
Jesus, my darling,
wanted to have Clay up here. I don't know, is my mic on or no?
It's on my side.
It's on. Oh, there we go. There we go. Clay got more likes this past year than any of us. So I thought it would be appropriate if we just brought him up here so he could, you could all see him. He's just 1 year old, but that's a lot of people, isn't it, bud? Good job. I want to mention a couple things. We're going to continue to have RSVPs to come to the service, and the phone number is going to be a little different. So we have the phone number there on the screen if you'd like to come again, and we're just going to take the RSVPs. Hopefully we can expand as time proceeds here and allow more people to come to worship, which would be fantastic. If you need something from us, we have the email on the screen, freshwind@westernhome.org, and then our mailing address. And then I want to again just thank you for your support this past year. I mean, it has been such a blessing to us as a team and in this community, and your support allowed us, you know, when everything was shutting down last year, it allowed us to keep a couple chaplains working in this community. And I can't tell you how crucial that is. And our team is just grateful for the opportunities that we've had, and I can't tell you how grateful we are to have the whole team back together working in this community. We're divided a little bit more. We're a little more focused as individuals in different regions of the Western Home community. And a lot of that is because of the support of so many people. And we're so grateful for that and thankful. We want to spend a little time in prayer together. But before we do that, we're going to sing one song about Christ. And it's kind of a Good Friday song. As a reminder, we didn't have a Good Friday service, but just of what Jesus did for us on that cross. So let's sing that. Him and pray. So Chris is going to start us off in prayer, and then I'll close, and then we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. So.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning with hearts full of thanks.
You carried the weight of the world and our sins up a hill on a day we call Good Friday, Lord. It was good for us, but it was the weight of our sins and the weight of the world that you bore that day. And this morning, Father, we know that you did that because you love us with an immeasurable love, one that we cannot even comprehend. And so we come before you this morning with hearts full of gratitude, full of praise, because after you carried that cross up that hill, Lord, 3 days later, we celebrate that you are not dead anymore. That stone was rolled away. Mary didn't know where you went. But you promised, Lord, you would rise again, and you did it. And we thank you and praise you and forever are thankful for an eternal home with you because of your victory over the grave that day. Hallelujah. We celebrate that this Easter, Father, and we thank you from the bottom of our hearts for a chance to be together as a church, to do it in unison. You call your people, Father, to a life of freedom, a life of victory, a life of hope, a life without fear. Forgive us for falling into traps of fear and doubt and despair, Father. Forgive us because at the end of the day, we win because of you. So help us turn a corner in our hearts and our minds today, Lord. Help us live with that hope, that joy, that peace that makes others want to know what's going on. Help us have an approach to life, Lord, that is just infused with your spirit and your energy. We thank you so much again for the gift of today.
Yes, Father, we do thank you and give you praise. And I thank you for each person in the room here and the life that you've given us and those that will watch online or on television. We thank you for them. Thank you for the opportunity we have to serve you in life and the very gift of life, as Chris mentioned. And we give you praise and thanks for the gift of your Son. And Father, we come to you together. You instructed us to pray when the disciples went, and you said, teach us to pray. And you gave them sort of a format, an outline for prayer, suggesting different ways that we can come to you and giving us direction about things to pray for. And so now we come to you in that prayer that has been a traditional prayer that we've offered. And we give it to you from our hearts. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You're the bells ringing.
As I was approaching Easter this year, this weekend, obviously I was praying about my own life and all that we've been through and thinking, and just needed the reminder of Easter and what Easter reminds us of. And there's so many things that Easter reminds us of. And I got into looking through the four gospel writers and their accounts of the Easter story, and I just didn't realize how much I needed to sit with the story again and be reminded of a few things about God. And that shouldn't surprise me, because, you know, what is a reminder, but it is a thing that causes someone to remember something. And as I've gotten a little older, I've needed more and more reminders in my life. I don't know if you can relate to that. I am so thankful for modern technology, which can remind us in so many unique and special ways. Yes. And I use my phone a lot for reminders. Anyone else do that? I set a lot of things in my calendar to pop up and tell me when this is coming, when that is coming. And then I set notes in my phone to remind me of certain things. And I write little notes on my desk. I have one there just now, I thought of this morning, to remind me of something tomorrow morning. It seems like as I've gotten older, just the humility to do all these things helps my life work better. And my kids happened to get me for Christmas this last year one of these tile apps. And it reminds me where things are. Like my billfold. It's got a little thing in my billfold that if I lose my billfold, I can hit my phone and my billfold will start to beep. That's the gift that keeps on giving. I have a little tile on my keys so that I can beat my keys. And yesterday we were running around in here and I left my keys somewhere and I could not remember where. They just happened to be back in that room on a shelf when I hit the little tile. It reminded me where I put them. We need reminders. And Jesus said at the Last Supper, "Do this in remembrance of me." And we gather together, we open God's word. And some of us have heard the message of Easter many times. But as we look at it and come around again and remind ourselves of the story and let the story settle in on us, it can speak to us in different ways every year. And that's what it did for me this year. The first thing that really settled in on my spirit as I studied the story this year was that Easter reminds us, the account in the scripture, that God himself is unlimited in power. He's unlimited in power. Obviously, the resurrection is a demonstration of great power. The factual evidence of the resurrection is really indisputable when you study it. Somehow Jesus was crucified, was speared, he died, he was put in a grave, and then his body was no longer there. It's a demonstration of great power. But before we get to the resurrection, you can study the scriptures and see this is true from Genesis to Revelation. Jesus, even when he was beginning his ministry, was teaching at one point along the side of the lake shore. It got so crowded there, he invited his disciples to get into a boat and cross over to the other side with him. And when they were in the boat crossing over, the Bible says Jesus fell asleep. He took a nap there. He was tired. He had a busy schedule. And I'm sure he just decided to lay back in some part of the boat and rest. And while he was sleeping, the scripture says a squall came up, which is a wind on the lake. And of course, with a squall comes waves, and the disciples started to get nervous. And then they got more and more nervous as the winds continued to howl. And Jesus just kept sleeping. And so they decided to finally wake him up, and they shook him. And Mark chapter 4, verse 39 says he got up and he rebuked the wind and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." And the wind died down, and it was completely calm. The disciples were amazed, and they said, "Who is this that even the wind and the waves obey him?" We live in a world that worships power, primarily political power. But the Bible assures us that there is no political power that can surpass the power of God. Amen. The Bible assures us that all authorities in heaven and on earth are under His authority. They don't hold more power than Him. It might seem that human beings have a lot of power, but the truth of the matter is, compared to God Almighty, they really don't. John chapter 1 verse 3 says, through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. He's the genesis of all things. He's the one who out of nothing made everything that we know of. Human beings don't have the capacity to make something out of nothing. But God does. He is unlimited in power. In Him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones, powers, rulers, authorities, all things were created by Him and for Him. And when we get then to Easter Sunday morning, it really shouldn't be a huge surprise to us that when the ladies got to the tomb that morning, what He had said was going to happen had happened. He not only just has the power over the created world and the biological world, but of life itself. Every breath you and I take, every amount of oxygen that keeps us alive, every cell in our being is held together by Christ. We're alive because of Him. He is in all things. He holds all things together, and He sustains all things. So when they got to the tomb, and the angel said to the women, "Don't be afraid. I know you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as He said." We shouldn't be surprised. He's unlimited in power. No one matches His power. Secondly, I was observing through the entire Easter week how much Jesus Himself was in charge. He was, in this instance, as always, completely sovereign. Absolute and rule authority over territory, a state, or in this case, the universe. It starts with little things at the beginning of Easter that you see this about God, about Christ. He sent His disciples ahead to get a donkey. He knew where the donkey was. He knew that the donkey needed to be brought to Him. The disciples were a little confused about this because they said, what do we say to the owner when he asks us when we're taking this donkey, what are we doing with the donkey? He said, well, tell him the master needs it. Somehow Jesus was aware of all of this in His sovereign rule, and He wanted to fulfill a 500-year-old prophecy that the king comes riding to you on the foal of a donkey, a colt. And so you see His rule here in this little incident. But as He goes into Jerusalem and rides on that donkey, you have all kinds of leaders who think they're in charge. The Jewish leaders, the religious leaders of the day, they have a certain amount of authority there in Jerusalem. And they're working to keep that authority. They're threatened by Jesus because He's growing in popularity, and they're doing what they can to trick Him. They've already done it many times, trying to trap Him and trying to get rid of Him. They were even doing the same thing for John the Baptist. But see, they weren't pulling the strings. It hadn't been Jesus' time yet. God Himself was pulling the strings. He was orchestrating the week. They were trying to stop Him. Jesus went in the temple. He cleared out the temple. There were many times they could have apprehended Him, but Jesus didn't let them until the time was right. He was pulling the strings, just as He is today. Easter reminded me how sovereign God really is. When Jesus was brought before Pilate, Pilate could find no fault in Him. And he wanted to free Him. Pilate went out to talk to the Jewish people, and they didn't want Him freed, they want Him crucified. And so Pilate went back in to talk to Jesus. And he asked Jesus, John chapter 19. Where do you come from? Jesus gave him no answer. Do you refuse to speak to me, Pilate? Don't you realize I have power to free you or to crucify you? And Jesus answered him, verse 11, you would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Pilate was not in charge. Herod was not in charge. The religious leaders were not in charge. The great Caesar was not in charge. And the same is true in our world today. We may have elected officials, we may have human organizations, but in the end, God's plan will not be thwarted. He will not be stopped. He is all powerful. No one can thwart his hand. He is the sovereign God of the universe from which everything came. And his will and his purposes will be accomplished on earth as it is in heaven. No one will stop him. He is completely powerful, completely sovereign. And you won't hear this on the evening news. Many people don't believe it. But no one has more authority than him. And if you read the Easter story, you'll see that Jesus himself, weeks before, turned his face towards Jerusalem. And of his own free will, he could have done anything he wanted. Of his own free will, he headed into Jerusalem, set his face like flint towards Jerusalem, not because he is unlimited in power, not because he's sovereign, but because of this best part yet. Because he is unending in love. Servant leadership begins with Jesus.
Amen.
And we need more of it. People who will, at whatever cost, do what is best for the people around them. He was pulling the strings, setting up his own crucifixion in love. He was doing it. And no one was going to stop him. No one takes my life from me. He said, I lay it down. Romans 5:8. God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were yet rebellious, sinners, Christ died for us. Unlimited in power, completely sovereign, and unending in love. I needed these reminders. And when you know his love, it just makes all the difference. It makes all the difference.
That's right.
His love grounds you as an anchor for your soul. It frees you from the fear of death. It gives you a renewed sense of hope. And when it comes to the end, it is the only comfort that we have. I have a picture of Wendy Noyes here. Wendy played piano for us before we shut down. And Wendy was an energetic, vibrant worshiper of God. We liked having her.
Yes.
And Mike and Sherry Ann are here with us today. February 13th, Wendy got up, it was a Saturday morning, wasn't it? And she passed out and was gone. Mike, I was on the phone with you Friday, and we talked a little bit about it, and have the next slide there, Joe. We don't have to wonder where she is. You said it 10 times. We know.
Right.
We know. In the end, it makes all the difference. I have a picture of Carrie Eller here. Carrie attended worship here, sat back in the corner here with his family oftentimes, and his family's here today. And they wanted, after Fresh Wind opened, for the first service to be a time when we honored Carrie. I stopped and visited with Carrie a few times, and he often had tears in his eyes after the service. The Lord was ministering to him in those last years of life. And Carrie had a connection with God through Christ. His family writes, Carrie was the most loving husband, father, grandfather, son, and brother. He loved homemade chocolate cake. He often hid the pan so he wouldn't have to share. He had a real sweet tooth. He was so proud of his children, Tiffany, and husband Glenn, Troy, and wife Casey. The family admits to knowing how much that he loved them gives their life inspiration, even today. Most of all, he loved each and every one of his grandchildren, Luke, Ty, Joe, Delaney, and Lauren. He never missed their sporting events, and his deep voice made him the loudest fan there. Luke said his grandpa was throwing a curveball, but he showed the family how to dig deep for faith and strength and to fight for life while battling an incurable cancer for 4 years. And then Carrie and his body gave way, and he stepped out of his body, and to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
Amen.
Through Christ. The family is praying that their tears for missing him will fade away in time, and that they will have more memories to share with Carrie when they get there. Do not fix your eyes on things you can see, the Bible says, but fix your eyes on that which is unseen. For that which is unseen is eternal. Easter reminds us that the unseen God is all-powerful. He is still pulling the strings in our world, no matter what the news says. His purposes will not be thwarted, his plan will not be stopped, and his love is unending. He's being patient in love right now, not wanting any to perish, but more to come, to find life in him. I want to ask you again just to pray for our community here, that the message of Christ, the love of Christ, could continue to expand here in the state and then in the world. Because if God's people aren't praying and we're not inviting him to come in and do his work, he's looking for people of faith so that he can expand his work.
Right.
There's nothing greater going on the planet. I thank you for your partnership. Let's stay at it.
Right. Amen.
Let's stay at it. Marlene Engen is in the back. I talked to her on the phone earlier this week. And we were talking about Easter, and she was reminding me that God has commissioned believers in the world to be ambassadors for him, to be messengers for him as strangers in this land, to share the news of another land. And then she said this, we carry the gem. We carry the antidote. We carry, if you may, the vaccine. We carry the answer. Jesus Christ was crucified for our sins and then resurrected as an affirmation of all that he said was true. And then Marlene said this, but we don't tell anyone. We don't tell anyone. It may even get more dangerous to tell people. Mm-hmm. But we can't stop.
Right.
It's all there is. And in the end, it's all that matters. Thank you for coming today. We're going to sing one more song together. I'm going to offer a prayer. I just pray that the Lord, through this time and as what's happening in our country, will encourage you to walk more closely with him, be more filled by him, and be more available to him and what he might have for you in your life. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for the chance to regather here. Thank you for watching over us this past year and your sustaining grace. We know it's you that carries us along, as your word says. Those that have gone before us were carried along by your Holy Spirit, and you're carrying us along now. We're so utterly dependent upon you. And Lord, our whole world is so utterly dependent upon you. And so we ask you to have mercy on our world. Forgive our straying hearts and call us back to yourself. Help us be more open to you. Would you till the soil of our hearts? Till the soil of the hearts of our leaders, that they may be softened and listening, seeking you for wisdom. This is the help we need, Father. Only by your Spirit are people drawn to you. So help us be a people of prayer, and then a people who are available to do your bidding, whatever you ask for us. Thank you for each person here today. Encourage them wherever they're at in their faith journey. Draw them closer to yourself and help them know your love more fully in their hearts. All of us, Lord, do this for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So as Hispanic, I have to, growing up in Mexico and with that part of my life, it's really hard to sit still through a message like this. I get all twitchy. So ready to go and out there. And Tim, we thank you for a message that reminds those of us that have said yes to Jesus that we need to continue to do so. But then I don't know if you heard the second part of it, is that it's also about introducing people to Jesus so they have the opportunity to know that there is a God who, even though we say no to him, he never stops saying no, yes to us. So Easter changes everything.
Yeah.
Easter changes absolutely everything. It changes your life and mine, and it changes our eternities forever. And so the question that we ask as a team, do you know that? Have you said yes, a definitive yes, to this gift of the death, the payment for our sins, and then the resurrection and the hope of life everlasting in Jesus? So we're going to get twitchy here in a little bit. We're going to sing, and may we sing just from the fullness of our hearts that because of what has been done for us at the cross and in the empty tomb, because Jesus lives, oh, everything changes. So let's sing good and loud, and let's rejoice in the fact that we can gather once again together. I'm looking more forward to when we can have more people gathered in the room, but what a joy to be able to gather together. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's sing.
Sent his son.
again for joining us today, and I want to remind you we have some cards at the desk there if you want to RSVP. It's a different phone number for next week. We want to just keep encouraging each other in our faith here and walking as we lift each other up and gather together to encourage each other. God's Spirit can literally change us and do these miracles in our hearts and help us live in this fresh way that God invites. Too many of you have done this for years. You've been an encouragement to us. We want to just continue to allow this to happen in our communities. Thank you for praying for that. If you've never opened your heart to the gift of Jesus, why not today? Why not right now in your heart? Why not just say, Father, and you can pray with me, Father, I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sin through Christ. I receive Jesus into my life. And Jesus, the Bible tells us, God told us this so that we could know. We can know we're his children forever in his hand. I had a friend just finished reading the Bible, and here's what he said. He sent me a text. He said, oh, I hope my name is written in the book of life. I hope. And I sent back to him, I said, if you've opened your heart to Jesus, it is.
Amen.
It's penned in there. If you have Jesus, you have life and life eternal. Happy Easter to you. Thanks for coming. I'll say a prayer, and then we're going to stand and sing the closing chorus here together. Father, thank you for the gift of life. Thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus, the great hope we have in him. Thank you that you're sovereign over all that's happening in our world today. Thank you that nothing can thwart your hand, that even though it may seem out of control, it's not out of control for you.
Right.
Help us have you as that anchor for our soul. Trust in your power and your might, and live in that hope that comes from your Spirit, from your hand, from the resurrected Christ. Thank you, Father. And for someone here, anyone here who hasn't opened their heart yet to you, and they're doing that, Lord, come into them. Give them that gift of eternal life that they could walk in newness. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I invite you to stand for the final verse.